Hey guys, we're looking at the European version of the Rad Power Bikes Rad Mini. Really exciting to see this coming to Europe along with the Rad Rhino. So I've checked these out in past years. Now they have a step-through version. They're really investing a lot and expanding to countries like Germany, France, Belgium, the Netherlands. It's spec'd a little bit different than the US version, which I've been reviewing for a long time. And they actually, they've been labeling these bikes. So there's like different generations of the bikes. This one is four. So they've been making the Rad Mini for four generations. This is a folding fat tire bike. And these fat tires have also changed in recent years because they've got the Rad Runner that introduced 20 by 3.3 inches versus 4 inches. So you can imagine 3.3 versus four. It's still gonna give you stability and float and comfort. They've got this proprietary like kind of checker pattern here. They're labeled K-Rad, and that's a reference to Rad Power Bikes. You can see down here the co-branding going on. Pretty neat to see that happening. I mean, they put a lot of work into the kind of attention to detail, the labels here on the battery pack, even the display. This is King Meter. So these are recognized brands that I've seen on other affordably priced electric bikes. This bike's €1,599, okay? So depending on where you're at, there's a lot of conversions and stuff. I've recorded as much detail as I can back at electricbikereview.com so you can really get into it with this bike because there's just so much to talk about. But for me, the experience has been really good. I talked about comfort, and for me on a folding bike, that's a big deal. Like not only does it have those higher volume tires, but you've got a suspension fork, and it's, you know, it's heavier than an air fork. It's not like the high-end electric mountain bike suspension fork, but it does have progressive lockout. See, so you can move that. This is compression adjust all the way to lockout, so you could reduce the bobbing feeling or that sinking feeling if you weigh a lot, or maybe you get the optional front rack that they offer, which is really nice, by the way. It connects to the frame, so when you're turning, the rack doesn't spill side to side. Same thing when parking, it's not gonna kinda lean over to the side. I think that's really nice. However, back to this suspension fork, it's got that lockout. It's also got preload, so you can preload the spring if you're someone who weighs a lot or you've got that rack, and that way, let's say you have the suspension fork in the open position, you're not using up that travel just based on your starting weight. Do you know what I mean? Like, I'm a lightweight guy, so personally, I keep it pretty far open. I don't preload it very much. The way it's set up right now without a rack, we've got this light, 80 lumens. They've got this cool light ring around the sides, and then in the center, there's a focused beam. You can aim this. It actually lights up the path fairly well. So in the past, it feels like their lights have been more about being seen and safety. Now it actually feels like they're lighting your way pretty well, and I appreciate that. You know, in addition to the headlight, we've got a rear light. It's only one LED in this thing, but it does have several modes. So there's like a kind of a flashing mode, and then there's a brake mode where when you pull the brake levers, not only does it have a motor inhibitor, which goes through that controller there and tells your motor to shut off, but it's also giving kind of a bright signal, just like an automobile. So really like that they're going for safety, and you'll notice that it's on this metal bracket that raises it a little bit so it can clear the fender. Rad Power Bikes has an optional rear rack as well, and then the light comes with an extension cable so you can mount it to the back of the rack. Really well done. These are, they're very modular bikes. So the same battery pack as you have on the Rad Mini is used on the Rad Rhinos and the Rad Runner. And that's great because you might have a family or friends and someone might go for like a really long ride and you could have that rack. You could take an additional battery pack. This is a 48 volt, 14 amp hour, 672 watt hour pack. Weighs about 7.7 pounds. So, you know, we got a little four LED charge level indicator right there. This nice kind of, you know, semi-aerodynamic shape. It slides on like this. It mounts and then slides down. And depending on which frame we're talking about, like if it's the Rad Minis, you might have to raise the seat and turn it or take it off. So getting the battery on and off on some models is a little easier. On others, takes a little bit more time. Here's the charging port on the right-hand side. It's got a little rubber cover that's fairly easy to use. Sometimes those aren't so easy to use on other bikes. They don't seat very well. They do have two fuses right there, which is nice. I don't have an IP rating, ingress protection rating, but they say they're highly water resistant, just like the motor and the display. So they say you can ride these bikes around in rain and in wet conditions. You're definitely not supposed to submerge them or anything, but it's nice that they warranty them for that 1 year comprehensive and that the battery pack replacements are a little more affordable because the controller unit is separate. And then another unique quality about these batteries is that the locking mechanism has three different slots. So right now you could slide it onto the bike because that pin is not protruding. And then once it's on, you could kind of push and turn and it'll lock to the frame, and you can remove the key, and in this mode, it's off, so no one can tamper with your display, which is kind of cool. No one's gonna be able to use the throttle or anything, and then you take it to that next step, right, still locked, and now take the key out, the bike will work. So it's really cool for people who don't wanna take this off their bike but don't want people tampering. You kind of lock it and turn the bike off. I think that's really nice, and there are a lot of other bikes that don't do that, so good job, Rad. The motor is like 8.7 pounds, so you can see some of the weight is a little bit more towards the rear on the bike, but that suspension fork actually adds a little bit of weight, and the bike ends up being fairly evenly distributed. I weighed this at roughly 67 pounds, and again, I've got the conversions to metric and stuff back at the website. And this is the European Charger. It's the same one they use in North America. Pretty lightweight, weighs roughly 1.1 to 1.5 pounds, depending on the additional cable you've got. So they have C13, Type G, Type F, and since they sell this all over the place in Germany, the United Kingdom, Netherlands, France, Belgium, it's really cool that they were thoughtful about this. And I only have two of the plugs here, but it's kind of neat to see. And this charger puts out 2 amps, so it can take a little bit longer. Roughly 6 hours if your battery is completely depleted, just because it is such a high capacity battery at 672 watt hours. So keep that in mind. Now they include these 110 millimeter wide fenders. So back to the lights. I really like that the headlight is very functional, it's focused, and they're now, look at this. This is an aluminum alloy cooling chip, like a heat sink, like you might have on a computer or something. So that's kind of neat. I think it looks cool. And then we have reflective sidewalls on the tires. The Rad Mini, it only comes in this high step black color right now, okay? So being seen is important, especially when you're lower to the ground like this. You want cars and maybe just other cyclists just to see you and to notice, so you don't get hurt and you don't end up in an accident. So I feel like they've done a really good job at that. Other things that stand out to me, they kind of go above and beyond. We've got this aluminum alloy chain guide, and that protects the chain and everything when you fold. It also keeps the chain from hopping off. It doesn't allow your pants to touch the chain and get greasy or snag. You can still see a little bit of grease here from all the rides I've been doing, but not nearly as much as if there was no chain guide. We've got these extra wide aluminum alloy platform pedals from Welgo. They're folding, so you're gonna get kind of minimal space use when this is completely folded. Quick release on that front wheel, which is nice if you do have maybe like even more limited space. You want to remove the battery and the wheel to really make this lighter if you're lifting it on your own. Nice to have quick release there. You really shouldn't have too many problems with punctures though on these tires, because they also have the Kenda, kind of this K-Shield, the puncture resistant tire casing. Definitely appreciate that. 12 gauge spokes front and rear, they're black. They blend in with the rims and the motor. One area that Rad could take it to the next level, in my opinion, is if they got like, kind of punched out rims, right? They could take a little bit of weight off these rims. The spoke pattern though is pretty tight here, so I feel like they're going for strength rather than some of the lightweight. And with the fenders and stuff, I guess what I'm trying to say is this weighs a little bit more than it looks like. It actually weighs pretty close to some of the full-size Rad Power bikes. And I, you know, again, removing the battery and the front wheel, those are really your best options. So some of the other specs that I want to point out, 27.2 millimeter seat post. You can get a suspension post from them, and that'd add even more comfort. So it really combines nicely with that front fork. It's not a true full suspension feel like if you had a rear suspension, but with these higher volume tires, it's pretty good. It's pretty good. And you know, the thing about folding bikes, they usually do have these 20 inch wheels. That gives you a higher attack angle. So, you know, on the bumps and on these divots and stuff, you kind of fall down into them a little bit more. You run into them rather than spanning them with these slightly larger, even higher volume tires. So if you're someone who's really looking for the comfort and maybe the highest performance, I think the Rad Rhino is probably the way to go. But again, it doesn't really fold down. It has a much higher standover height, so mounting it isn't quite as easy. And that's why they've introduced the step-through Rad Rhinos. So, you know, coming back to the Mini, this has a lot of the same features and the same drive modes and everything. And again, I'm going to get to that in just a second, but I want to finish with some of the specs. Telescoping stem. We've got a really short like stem adapter up here, so the handlebar isn't far out. You don't have to lean really far out. They've got a kind of a low-rise handlebar that can be swiveled forward or back to increase or decrease your reach, but this does only come in one size. So that's one of the trade-offs. The other trade-off is that you're working with mechanical disc brakes here, and they're four-finger levers with the rubberized edge, which is as nice as you can get for mechanical. You've even got the built-in bell. Both of them have those motor inhibitors, and that's why there's so many cables up here. But not being hydraulic means that you do have to use a bit more hand effort, and then the housing, it seats in over time, so it means you might need to adjust this and come down and do a little bit of work, but it's a lot easier to adjust yourself than hydraulic brakes. So it's kind of a trade-off, okay? And they've gone with the really large size rotor on this. This is 180 millimeters on this disc brake rotor, which is pretty good. Now, if you look at the smaller wheel size, I talked about the higher attack angle and everything, but you actually get a good mechanical advantage for the motor because it's not having to turn this really tall, really wide, even heavier wheel. You're getting a mechanical advantage. It's going to be the best climber. And that's the same thing for that disc brake rotor. 180 millimeters is almost overkill, but considering all the racks and stuff that they offer, it's nice that they did that. They even have like a YEP compatible like window on one of their rear racks, so that's cool if you have kids or something and you've got that cushy rear tire and you can commute all over the place and have a blast, maybe even go off-road like we're doing here today. You know, that's worth calling out. Also, great job on the kickstand placement. See how it's pretty far back? You're not going to get heel strikes, which is something I really think about when, especially on a smaller platform like this, you don't want to get snagged up and everything. Now, when you kick it up like this, you'll notice that there's a pretty good amount of clearance between the bottom of the kickstand and that disc brake rotor. I've seen some other bikes where it actually slaps in and you hear like ding, and you don't want to do that over time because that gets bent and then there's more noise when you're braking. While we're down here, check out this steel torque arm. So what they're doing is the motor axle is actually fitted into this aluminum alloy frame. Okay, and it pushes against the frame, and there's a lot of power in this, even though it's spec'd down a little bit for Europe and European standards. They still got that torque arm, and that makes it so it doesn't chew into the frame over time as you're starting and stopping that motor. Good job. I did not get a torque rating on this motor. In the United States, it's 80 newton meters. I suspect it's a bit less here for Europe. This is rated at 250 watts nominal, with a top speed of 15.5 miles per hour, 25 kilometers per hour. So that's the standard. It's a class one electric bike, pedal assist only, but they're doing some interesting things. They have this walk mode, sort of a twist mechanism that activates that. And when you twist it, you can actually override. And again, very cool what they're doing. It's really opening this motor up to a few more uses and kind of blending the experience in a way that I find really enjoyable. So this is a Befang fat bike specific planetary geared rear hub motor. It's going to spin efficiently. If you've got the bike off, there's no cogging drag, there's no regenerative braking or anything like that, but it's smaller, it's more compact than a gearless motor. So yep, now we come over to the other side. This is another real highlight for me. Instead of going with Shimano Tourney like a lot of the other entry-level folding bikes, which is the base level, they've gone with Altus. It's one level up, a little bit lighter, a little bit better materials that they're using. It does have a barrel adjuster, so you remember I talked about that housing sort of settling in over time. You can twist this to the left and it's going to kind of unthread and stretch out a little bit, so it's going to compensate for the housing settling in. You can do that yourself without any tools. I think that's kind of neat. There is a little bit of chain bounce, you know, you don't have like a clutch on this or anything, but it's hopefully well protected because they've got this steel derailleur guard. That's important for a folding bike, like if it tips over, or maybe you're putting this in the back of a truck or storing it in your closet and stuff gets piled up on top of it, because this is one of the more sensitive bits on the bike. Quick disconnect for the power cable, a lot of other cables going on back here, but they're arranged fairly well. Here's the light cable, and then the freewheel. This is really another just great choice by Rad. It's 11 to 34 tooth, whereas a lot of other sort of entry-level drivetrains that are freewheels, they're 14 to 28. So you don't get that really tall, low gear, which is perfect and necessary for climbing and starting. You also don't get that really small, high gear to help you hit and maintain higher speeds. Now, it's kind of overkill for this bike, considering the top assisted speed is that 25 kilometers per hour. It's still nice to see. We got a 12 magnet cadence sensor right there at the middle of the bike. It's sort of the old fashioned one, but it's fairly well protected by this big chain ring and all the guards and stuff. They have a new one that's sealed that could go on the left hand side of the bike, which we see on the Rad Runner. I guess they just skipped it here. I'm not sure exactly why, but the resolution is actually pretty good. It starts and stops very quickly, and you've still got the override switch, the motor inhibitors on the brake levers. So I think that's about it. We've also got the battery pack right here, which slides on and off the bike fairly easily, but you do have to kind of unlock your binder like this, and a lot of times twist the seat or maybe even just take it off to get to that battery because it slides up out of the frame. So here we go, I'm just gonna lock this again. And one thing I've noticed and really appreciated about this binder is that it's got such a long lever, so it doesn't require as much like finger strength. You've got a lot more leverage on that. That's a nice little thing that Rad has done for this bike and their other ones. So to turn the bike on, I'm gonna press the mode button here. It boots up fairly quickly. 2.75 inch grayscale LCD. It is backlit. Can't really see it right now because the lights aren't on. To get those, I hold up and mode. And we got a little icon there. I'll take you on a little tour again. So there's the headlight. And then we've got that backlight that goes bright when I pull the brake levers. Very nice. Oh, and I did want to say they've got that flashing mode. Pretty cool. That's something that's very rare. I don't see that on hardly any other e-bikes, especially with a lot of them don't even have lights that are integrated. So this is great. 5 ticks on the battery infographic right there. It'd be nice if there were 10 or maybe even a percentage readout, but this is how it's been for a long time. So I think this is a tried and true display panel from King Meter. Got odometer up there, and if we tap the mode button, it goes to trip distance. Down here we have current speed. If we want, we can hold the up button and it goes to average speed and then max speed. And then down here we have pedal assist level. It always starts in one, and the twist assist, that's active, but only up to like 6 kilometers per hour. So this is what I was talking about. This is like the walk mode thing, but they still have traditional walk mode, which is where you hold the down arrow for a second, and then there we go. You got a little help, which could be nice if you find yourself at the bottom of a hill and it's just too technical. You want to go up the rocks, and we're going to look at that later. It's nice to have a couple of options there to give you a hand with that. And I should say, if you take this down to no assist, you're going to be riding this like a traditional analog bicycle, then the walk mode, none of that stuff works. It's just basically you're going to get a readout and you're going to get the lights, which is kind of nice. And then we've got watts down here. So as I arrow up to 1, it says, okay, you got 50 watts. 2, you got 100 watts. 3, 150, 4, 200, and 5, 250. That's what I'm talking about. The interesting thing is, no matter what level you're in, let's say you're in 1 through 4, as soon as you twist that, it opens up level 5. So you get 250 watts as soon as you twist that, as long as you're pedaling. So that's what I'm talking about. They're kind of blending it. And for me, coming from North America, we have sort of throttle override, and it's a similar feature here. Again, it's not really a throttle. They're just calling it twist assist, but it unlocks those higher levels of assist more conveniently than if you had to go click, 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 click all the way up. Hope that makes sense to you guys. I also want to call out that they have a 1-amp standard size USB 2.0 charging port built into the base of the display. That could be really handy if you're someone who's got a phone, you're using it for GPS, or maybe a little speaker or some extra lights. So many possibilities. And considering that high capacity battery pack, it's nice that they did that. And then the range on this, I'm estimating 30 to 50 miles depending on you know, how you use the bike. I think they've been fairly generous, but very accurate on the weights and some of the range estimates compared to, again, some of these other brands where it feels like a bit of an exaggeration. So I wanted you guys to see this thing in the folded state. It actually gets pretty small considering how big those tires are. We're gonna have Eric come over here and help us unfold it and go through the steps. First thing you usually do is pull up that stem, lock it in place. It's really cool how it's extendable, but you can do that once you're standing over the frame. Kind of, yep, lift it up a little bit like this. Remember to be careful, 67 pounds, it's fairly heavy, and there's this locking pin that you have to lift before that joint will actually come together. I like that the joint on these bikes is fairly narrow because there are other folding bikes out there, especially ones with internal batteries. They don't necessarily even have the fat tires. They're kind of fat, and it can bump your knees or your shins and stuff when you're driving. So I like this design. I think it's pretty good. Thanks for updating the handlebars there. We got the pedals and stuff. Really awesome. Those aluminum alloy folding pedals, larger than most other folding e-bikes. And that makes a big difference, especially with the bigger tires. Maybe you have boots on or something. And then the last step is just to raise the saddle a little bit. We got that little handle there. So I think that's pretty useful when you're, you know, unfolding the bike or lifting it into the back of your RV. Thank you so much, Eric. Good job.
Yeah.
Hop on the bike. Take it all the way up to assist level 5. Gotta love that. Here we go. Awesome. Let's go for a ride.
Right.
Thanks, buddy. So, here we go. I'm going to pedal. Pretty responsive. That's important to me, especially with a cadence sensor. There we go. And very stable, back to those 3.3-inch tires. I'm gonna do some shifting now. And there we go. We passed our 25 kilometer per hour top speed, so the motor shut out and now it just kind of hovers around that mark. Do go in and make sure you get this tuned up right. Spend some time assembling it. Make sure everything feels good. I noticed that the stem, you can kind of, there's a little bit of slop in it, so you can kind of align those handlebars more perfectly with the front wheel, and I spent a few minutes doing that just to make sure the bike was all set before doing this ride. And there's the bigger SIS Index thumb shifter, very intuitive for people who might not be used to the little triggers, and they chose not to use those because they've got this bigger housing for that twist assist right there. So this is what it looks like to shift gears. It's actually pretty easy to do if you have gloves on. Maybe you're riding this in cold weather in the snow or something. Nice to have something that's so intuitive like that. And I love the bell. There we go. A little bit of a hum going on with that motor, just because it is a planetary geared motor. But it ramps up pretty smoothly. Like, there's some other e-bikes where it's like, whoa, it kind of takes you off. This one, I feel like they do a good job. I find myself riding in like assist level 3 or 4 a lot because it doesn't take me too fast. Yeah, and it's just a lot quieter. Okay guys, from here you can see that 48 tooth steel chainring. Steel makes it a little bit tougher, but we've got aluminum alloy guard. And that's what I was talking about. Keeps the pants clean, keeps the chain from bouncing off. And if it does get scratched, it's not gonna rust like steel. We've got those solid aluminum alloy platform pedals, the 11 to 34 tooth freewheel in the back. I'm just gonna ride along so you can hear that motor and you can watch me pedal and see how quickly it starts and stops. I think they've really done a good job dialing in that 12 magnet sensor. Great. It feels a lot more comfortable now because I took some air out of those tires just because I don't weigh that much. And frankly, even though it's a little less efficient, I'd rather be comfortable because I think I'll end up riding more and having a better time doing that. The tire pressure range here is 5 to 30 PSI, and I've taken it pretty close to that 5 just to get that soft feel. And you'll notice that with that great neoprene slap guard, it's a lot quieter. But there's still a little bit of noise, just I think from the chain guide, where there's a little bit of bumping happening there. Again, if there's any scratching, it won't rust. That's pretty good. I've had a good time on this. It's been fun riding around outside in a natural setting and really testing this thing off-road. For the full written review, I'll see you guys back at electricbikereview.com. I hope, I've recorded pretty much everything I can and I've tried to answer specific questions. Hope this helps you guys. This is a European model. Rad Power Bikes has a few in the United States I was able to spend some time with. So I've done my best to just go through, back at the site, there is a comparison tool. So you can look at this one versus maybe the Rad Runner or the Rad Rhino and just see what the differences are. You can also see the United States and Canada versions as well if you're traveling or something like that. So have fun out there. Love you guys. Ride safe. We'll see you next time.